Merci d'accueillir. Please welcome our master of ceremony, Alyssa Landry.
Bonsoir. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Bienvenue. Nous sommes ravis de vous accueillir à la conférence Star Wars ce soir. We are so delighted to welcome you to the Star Wars conference this evening. La saga Star Wars fascine des générations depuis bientôt 40 ans. Et nous sommes très contents d'accueillir ce soir une personne qui est fan depuis la première heure. The Star Wars saga has been fascinating generations of moviegoers for at least 40 years now. And tonight we are very happy to welcome someone who has been a fan from the very beginning. But before I present him, let's take a look at who he is en image. On va regarder notre prochain ami. Patrice Giraud,
bonjour. Vous êtes le grand spécialiste de Star Wars en France. Vous écrivez dans Star Wars Insider. Vous avez édité pendant 15 ans le magazine officiel de la série. Il y a un nouveau Star Wars qui va sortir en décembre prochain. Vous avez quelques petites infos, vous avez des craintes aussi?
Non, parce que Disney est un studio merveilleux, il n'y a que voir ce qu'ils font avec Pixar et Marvel. Il y a une super productrice à la tête de chez Lucasfilm, qui est Kennedy, qui était le bras droit de Spielberg depuis 30 ans. Eh ben, on va accueillir les acteurs de Star Wars. Vous avez entendu la voix de C-3PO dans plusieurs pays, j'imagine.
Oui, je me sens totalement à plus. Je crois qu'en enfance, c'est la meilleure. Oui.
Marketing, il y a quelque chose qui relève de la passion.
Vous savez, Star Wars, finalement, il ne devait pas y avoir d'autres films. Enfin, le cas, ça veut dire en 2005, il n'y aura plus de Star Wars.
Ouais.
Et finalement, retrouver Harrison Ford dans le rôle d'Han Solo, c'est comme retrouver quelqu'un qui était mort, qui revient. Finalement, c'est quelqu'un de votre famille qui revient et on est tous super contents. Han Solo, alors Han Solo incarbonite, hein, cet essai chez ILM, la bonne effet de George Lucas. Donc, ils ont effectivement moulé vraiment le visage d'Harrison Ford avec ses mains, mais tout le reste a été sculpté par des maquettistes, le torse et tout le reste, les effets de métal qui sont partout. Les objets qu'on voit sur les écrans, qu'on voit dans les bouquins, on peut enfin les approcher en vrai et voir le podresseur taille réelle. Ouais, c'est impressionnant, mais waouh, wow, c'est superbe. C'est la magie de ce qui a été créé dans les films qui se transmet dans les jouets et qui donne envie aux enfants de les avoir. Le dernier film date de 2005, les produits dérivés marchent toujours autant. Donc de toute façon, la marque Star Wars est plus forte que son créateur aujourd'hui.
Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Merci d'être là.
Merci d'être venu. Alors, fan depuis la première heure.
Fan depuis octobre 77. Voilà, j'avais 10 ans.
10 ans. He's been a fan since 1977 when he was 10 years old. Et c'est là où vous avez vu le film pour la première fois.
Voilà, sur les Champs-Élysées, donc pas loin, à Paris. Et on est tombé dedans et je suis devenu Luke Skywalker pendant 2 heures.
So he became Luke Skywalker on the Champs-Élysées. That's very chic.
Yes, very.
Et alors, donc c'est une passion qui vous a amené ensuite à
Bah oui, c'est une passion incroyable et j'étais fasciné par George Lucas, Star Wars, Indiana Jones, le THX. Et un jour, j'ai écrit à Lucasfilm et chose incroyable, j'étais pratiquement le premier au monde à leur proposer de faire un magazine Star Wars en France. Et j'ai créé le premier magazine à l'international en 1995.
Wow, so he one day took his courage in both hands, wrote to George Lucas and said, I want to start a magazine. And he was one of the first people to do it, so he created an international magazine on Star Wars.
Voilà.
And that was in the 1990s, I believe.
1995.
And then you went on to do even more things for Star Wars. I think you were in charge of an exhibit.
Oui, j'ai produit donc deux conventions officielles à Paris, et effectivement, la Cité des Sciences m'avait demandé avec Lucasfilm de scénariser et de choisir les objets pour produire l'expo Star Wars en 2005. Voilà, et c'est devenu le plus grand succès pour une expo dans le monde Star Wars, avec 750 000 visiteurs.
Wow, so in 2005, he was invited to write and choose all of the objects for the exhibit of the Star Wars collection in the Cité des Sciences, and it became the most successful Star Wars exhibit in the world with more than 750,000 visitors. That's really amazing. And so these were objects that came from George Lucas's personal collection.
Voilà.
But I think you have un collègue qui a aussi une collection assez étonnante. One of your colleagues also has an amazing collection.
Voilà.
He?
Donc à l'issue de cette exposition, j'ai un vieil ami qui s'appelle Arnaud Grimbert, je crois qu'il est ici, et qui est venu me voir, qui a sûrement une des plus belles collections d'objets de science-fiction au monde, dont des belles pièces de Star Wars. Il m'a dit, Patrice, qu'est-ce qu'on fait? Et je lui ai dit, bon, on va faire comme George Lucas, on va faire des expos dans le monde entier, et des livres, et plein de choses. Et,
d'ailleurs, je crois que vous venez de sortir un livre.
On vient de sortir un livre qui s'appelle Génération Science-Fiction au monde, ces belles pièces. Mais là, je crois qu'on vous a fait un petit clip où on va vous présenter quelques-uns de nos petits trésors.
Donc, on va prendre un look now at some of the objects that are in the collection of Arnaud and Patrice, and sciencefictionarchive.com. Let's take a look. On va regarder.
Bonjour, bienvenue dans les entrepôts de sciencefictionarchive.com. Aujourd'hui, je vais vous faire une petite visite privée de nos archives Star Wars et on commence tout de suite avec derrière moi l'incroyable vaporateur d'humidité qui a été utilisé par George Lucas en 1976 sur la guerre des étoiles. Et maintenant, je vous propose de le suivre dans le reste de la collection. Nous voici donc dans notre showroom, et ici je vous ai présenté une petite galerie d'objets Star Wars, pas des moindres bien sûr, et on va commencer ici avec un véritable R2-D2 fabriqué pour lancer contre-attaque, construit par la société White Horse en Angleterre, et qui a eu la chance de garder R2-D2, c'est là où on l'a récupéré il y a une vingtaine d'années, et c'est en fait le seul et unique R2-D2 hors des collections de chez George Lucas. La célèbre, fameuse veste de Luke à la fin de la guerre des étoiles, qui est un peu le symbole de la toison d'or. Et ici, donc, on la présente avec la médaille de Han Solo. À la fin du film, normalement, la médaille de Luke devait être donnée à George Lucas et la médaille de Han Solo à Gary Kurtz. C'est comme ça que nous l'avons récupérée. Il s'avère que George Lucas, apparemment, n'a jamais reçu sa médaille, et donc dans les archives de chez Lucas, ils n'ont aucune médaille de cette séquence, et que la seule au monde donc, est donc ici, devant vos yeux. Là, je vous présente une pièce vraiment unique. Il faut savoir que sur la guerre des étoiles, il y a eu deux cases de Dark Vador qui ont été fabriquées. N'existe plus, semble-t-il, a été détruit. Et voilà le second, donc le seul rescapé de la guerre des étoiles, et c'est donc le casque original de Dark Vador que l'on voit dans le film. Et en plus, on peut le repérer parce qu'ici, il y a une sorte de petite marque qu'on peut repérer facilement durant le tournage. Voilà donc une belle pièce unique de notre collection. Voici la main de Luke Skywalker dans l'Empire contre-attaque. Donc, c'est la fameuse séquence où Luke se fait couper la main par son père. Et donc, on avait affaire à l'époque à des effets spéciaux rudimentaires. Mark Hamill avait sa main comme ça, Dark Vador lui coupait la main, il appuyait, et la main était éjectée. Voilà, trucage rudimentaire à l'ancienne, pas besoin d'image de synthèse. Alors,
Alors cette pièce est étonnante bien sûr, mais on la connaît pour l'histoire qui est dans Empire contre-attaque, elle avait cette mythologie, mais avec le nouveau film qui arrive qui s'appelle Le Réveil de la Force, on va regarder cette pièce avec un nouvel angle puisque il semblerait que le fameux sabre perdu dans l'Empire contre-attaque se retrouve dans Le Réveil de la Force et soit une nouvelle aventure pour cette pièce. Voilà. Voilà, j'espère que ce petit florilège d'objets Star Wars vous a plu. Sachez que tous ces objets voyagent dans des expos ou sont présentés dans des livres. Et puis j'espère qu'un jour, vous aussi, vous aurez la chance d'aller voir. Voilà. Vous voyez, j'ai de la chance. Tous les jours, je suis dans Star Wars.
C'est pas mal. C'est pas Alors, racontez-nous, vous avez vu le Réveil de la Force ?
Deux fois.
Waouh. Et
effectivement, le sabre de Luke revient. Voilà.
Je n'en dis pas plus. Twice. And the lightsaber does come back, but he's not saying anymore. You have to go see the movie yourselves. So tell me, have you ever met George Lucas?
J'ai eu la chance de rencontrer George Lucas à maintes reprises, et la seconde fois d'ailleurs, c'était à Disneyland Paris en 93 pour l'inauguration de l'attraction Indiana Jones et le Temple du Péril.
Oh, so he's met George Lucas many times, and the second time was actually here in Disneyland Paris when they inaugurated the Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom attraction. Not bad. And did he ever, perchance, invite you to any of the movie shoots?
Eh ben oui, j'ai eu beaucoup de chance. En 97, il tournait le premier des nouveaux films, donc La Menace Fantôme, en Angleterre, au studio d'Evasdon. Et ils m'ont appelé, ils m'ont dit « Patrick, j'ai une bonne et une mauvaise nouvelle ». Je fais « Bon, bah, commencer par la mauvaise ». Alors la mauvaise nouvelle, c'est que tu viens sur le tournage de Star Wars. Je fais « Waouh, c'est pas vrai ». Si, si, c'est vrai. Mais je leur ai dit « C'est quoi la bonne nouvelle ?» Bah, la bonne nouvelle, c'est que tu vas faxer tout de suite tes dimensions, on va te faire un costume et tu vas être figurant dans le film. Voilà, donc c'était la cerise sur le gâteau.
Wow, amazing. So it was when they were shooting Phantom Menace, and he got a phone call and said « Okay, I've got good news and bad news for you ». Start with the bad news. Well, the bad news is you get to come and be on the movie shoot for Star Wars and interview everybody you want to. What's the good news? The good news is you need to send your measurements right away. You're going to be an extra. And that's how he found himself on the movie shoot of The Phantom Menace, and I think with some very prestigious people also. Was there the Coppola family,
voilà.
The Spielberg family?
George Lucas avait besoin de figurants, donc il a appelé Coppola, Spielberg, Mark Hamill, hein, Luke Skywalker, en disant « Tes enfants vont aller dans Star Wars ?»« Bah oui, bien sûr. Donc vous les envoyez à Londres, on leur fait des costumes et tout le monde va être dans le film. » Effectivement, on s'est retrouvé tout le monde pendant deux semaines. On nous a déplacé de mètre carré en mètre carré. Et à la fin, je suis un tout petit pixel vert. Voilà.
So they used the same 200 people and they just moved them around. He said at the end he's just one little teeny tiny pixel. A tiny one. Well now I'm going to introduce someone else who was also involved in that movie shoot. Voilà, on va vous présenter quelqu'un d'autre qui était sur ce tournage, le chasseur de primes.
Il jouait pas dans ce film-là.
Pardon.
Il jouait dans les films avant, mais c'est la première fois que je l'ai rencontré effectivement sur le tournage en 97. Voilà. Uh-huh. Et c'est le plus grand chasseur de primes.
Le plus grand, the biggest bounty hunter. Let's take a little look at the character of Boba Fett. On va regarder le personnage de Boba Fett en image. Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Boba Fett himself, Jeremy Bullock.
I do apologize, sorry. They sent me that way and I should have come this way. Move on me now. Let's see.
So yes, I think you were having trouble remembering that you were part of the dark side and not part of the Jedi.
Yes, I was sort of stuck between the stormtroopers, but I think I got out of it quite well.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, otherwise I would have been down and outside the thing and heard them. Could have happened.
Yes.
Boba Fett is Boba Fett.
Boba Fett is Boba Fett and a bad guy, if ever there was one.
No. He's misunderstood.
Ah, Boba Fett donc est mal compris. C'est pas un méchant du tout.
I don't understand. He's on his own and he does it well and that's it.
Voilà, c'est un solitaire en fait, Boba Fett.
We have 440 stormtroopers out there.
Ah, il y a 440 stormtroopers dehors, donc faites attention.
So if you need them, just call.
Yes, okay. Vous avez besoin d'eux, il suffit d'appeler.
Yeah, they're very quiet, they're fine.
Fantastic.
It's getting so late, she's giggling.
So tell me, what was it like to be Boba Fett?
It was, you know, to be quite serious, it was terrific. You know, to be able to put that costume on with help, you know, it was funny to stand there. And as people do, I was looking at myself in the mirror, first thing in the morning, just looking and going, and then someone comes in, you're already on set, you're, oh, sorry, yes. But you can do so much with the character, it's so good.
Yes, donc il s'admirait dans la glace dès qu'il mettait son costume, il se disait, oh là là, quel costume incroyable, jusqu'au moment où on lui disait, c'est le moment de tourner. Did it take you a long time to put that costume on?
Yeah, quite a long time to begin with, but I had a dresser to make sure that everything was correct. But as the time went on, and I was beginning to finish my stint, it was quick, it was 10 minutes, easy to put on.
Donc au début, ça lui prenait des heures pour mettre le costume, et à la fin, 10 minutes. Tellement il avait pris l'habitude. That's fantastic. And I think that you mentioned that your grandchildren don't really care that you were Boba Fett.
No, they sort of said, yeah, all right, but yeah. Granddad's going to start saying he went to see this thing, and it's Boba Fett again. But the youngest one wants to be a princess, the little girl.
Ah, fantastic. Yeah. Donc, ses petits-enfants, en fait, ils se disent, oh là là, Boba Fett, encore Boba Fett. Mais n'empêche que la plus petite veut être la princesse Leia.
Princess Leia, yes.
Princess Leia,
is she
absolutely.
Here?
Is she here?
No,
princess
just,
Leia? I haven't seen her tonight. Vous avez vu Princess Leia? Ah, bah non.
Yeah,
no. Sorry.
Oh, necessary.
But we do have two other really fantastic guests here tonight. And I think, in fact, one of them is a member of your family.
He certainly is.
He certainly is. Nos deux prochains invités, ce sont vraiment des invités de prestige. L'un est incroyable en effets spéciaux et l'autre un grand producteur de quelques petits films sans grande importance. On va regarder. Let's take a look at the films that these two incredible men have made.
Il a travaillé sur 2001 l'Odyssée de l'espace, il a travaillé sur deux James Bond. Il a été producteur associé sur l'épisode 4, réalisateur 3ème équipe sur l'épisode 4, producteur de l'Empire contre-attaque, du Retour du Jedi, d'Indiana Jones l'âge perdu, d'Indiana Jones et le temple maudit, d'Indiana Jones et la dernière croisade, de Roger Rabbit. On peut se rouler à scène.
Monsieur Robert Holtz!
Fond of science fiction movies, or is it a genre that it's just one among others?
I can't say I was particularly a science fiction buff, but of course when I did 2001 A Space Odyssey, it began a kind of pattern, and then of course Star Wars came along many years later. Now I am a science fiction buff. I wasn't particularly before, you know. Say like Indiana Jones was more the kind of thing I like, but I love it now. and I'd love to see it here. It's absolutely wonderful.
De faire un dernier applaudissement pour Monsieur Robert Black. Et vous vous rendez compte que vous étiez furieux et que vous avez laissé cet héritage technologique à toutes ces générations après et que ça a influencé le cinéma que vous comprenez des interprètes à vous.
Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, merci d'accueillir. Please welcome Robert Watts and Robert Planack. Haven't you? How did that come about, Robert?
Me first. Well, I met Gary Kurtz, who was going on to produce Star Wars, many years before in Los Angeles. That's when Lucas was doing a film called American Graffiti. And he came to see me to ask me about filming in England. And so when the time came for Star Wars to appear, I got a call from 20th Century Fox saying, Gary Kurtz wants to see you. So I went along. I wasn't the only person up for the job, but I got lucky and got the job because Stanley Kubrick recommended me.
Oh, my heavens. Donc voilà, en fait, il connaissait bien Gary Kurtz, et au moment où il cherchait quelqu'un pour Star Wars, ben, il a été appelé, en quelque sorte, il a auditionné avec plein d'autres gens, et finalement, il pense qu'il a eu le job parce que Stanley Kubrick l'a recommandé. C'est pas mal comme recommandation.
Non, c'est formidable.
And you've been a part of this adventure too from the beginning, and in fact, I believe that you actually won an Oscar for your work.
I did win an Oscar for the first movie, Visual Effects.
Yes.
Indeed, indeed. But way back when, it wasn't, it really was a phone call from John Dykstra, who I had worked with on a couple of small projects. And he said, you want to work on this movie with me and help me set up the studio and do the optical composite part of it. And I hesitated. I said, when I learned it was 2 years, I said, that's too long. But eventually he persuaded me, and I'm very glad that he did, because it turned out to be quite an adventure.
Donc au début, en fait, on lui a proposé d'être le chef du département optique, et il a dit, oh, 2 ans, non. Mais finalement, on a réussi à le convaincre, et il est très content finalement d'avoir participé à ce projet, qui n'était pas... voué au succès au début. It wasn't necessarily believed that this would become a success at the beginning, was it?
Well, I think the people that this audience is in love with it, I think. And you're saying yes.
Vous êtes amoureux du film? De la saga Star Wars? Oui. Donc vous dites oui à Star Wars?
40 years ago, there would have been nobody in the audience, and they all would have, there would have been no in the room.
Voilà, il y a 40 ans, il n'y aurait eu personne dans le public, et à la réponse, vous aimez Star Wars, on aurait dit non.
So the lessons for you guys that aspire to make movies is go with what you feel is going to work, and don't listen to what people say, no, 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 no. Because that was the environment at the time. The studio didn't believe it could be done. The visual effects experts at the time didn't believe it could be done. We didn't know if it could be done, but we said, okay, we're going to try to do it. And that's the way to approach it.
Donc voilà, si vous faites des films aujourd'hui, n'hésitez pas à vous inspirer de Star Wars, parce qu'à l'époque, personne n'y a cru. Tout le monde a dit que les effets spéciaux, ça ne peut pas se faire. Tout par rapport au film ne pouvait pas se faire. Et finalement, ça s'est fait, et quel succès. Donc n'hésitez pas à vous en inspirer. Well, thank you all so much for being here with us tonight. Did you want to say anything else, Robert?
Seulement, bonsoir Paris. J'espère que vous allez aimer le nouveau Guerre des Étoiles.
Thank you all for being with us here tonight. Merci de votre attention. Nous allons vous laisser maintenant avec un documentaire inédit en France sur Star Wars. We're going to leave you now with a documentary that has never been seen in France before about Star Wars. Donc merci encore pour votre attention. Encore un tonnerre d'applaudissements pour nos invités. Patrick Giraud, Charlie Burke, Barbara, and Robert Flanagan. Woo! Thank you all for being here tonight, and may the force be with you.
It was so jaw-dropping when I first saw Star Wars. It had such an impact on me when I was studying film, and it really played a part in driving me into the film industry.
I was 11 years old, seeing the film for the first time. It was such a profound thing, not just because the movie itself was so entertaining, but because it said anything is possible.
I remember seeing it, and I just felt like, I know what I'm doing for the rest of my life. I am sitting here watching this tape over and over until I die.
I remember my dad putting me in the car to take me to see it. And I said, where are we going? He said, we're going to see the most amazing thing you've ever seen.
You can't compare Star Wars to anything that came before it.
It was breaking new ground in ways that no one had ever really seen before.
I grew up in the late 70s, early 80s, and it was everywhere.
The word epic gets thrown around a lot now, but it really was just so huge.
As a kid, I really just loved that universe. And as I got older, I think I appreciated the filmmaking part of it more.
When we look at Star Wars, it is unbelievable how much they got right. Like, not just the story, and not just the characters, not just the casting, not just the design, not just the music, but all of it. When you look at all of it, and you think that didn't exist prior.
It is this strange combination of huge, massive world creation spectacle and really intimate psychological character stories.
What George hit upon was this kind of fun, exciting, adventure, self-empowerment kind of storytelling.
You may get sucked into it for some of the more fun aspects of it, and then as you grow up, the films grow up with you because you become older and more sophisticated and are able to peel back some of those mythic layers and appreciate those as well.
All the people that worked on the designs for these films tapped into something perfect artistically. So just the shape of the Millennium Falcon, the shape of the idea of lightsabers.
And I remember seeing the graphic quality of the Death Star
the TIE fighters with those twin wings, the X-Wings. And those were all just, you know, such iconic shapes. They were like logos, essentially.
And it feels old, some of it, worn out helmets. And you go, well, whatever's in this universe has been going on for a very long time.
It had the random scuff marks and the scorching and the sort of junk in the corners and all the sort of little things that build up in everyday life that generally didn't appear in science fiction up to that point.
We'd never seen anything like it before, the visual effects in the movie. We didn't call it that. I mean, it looked real. It felt real.
There has been an awakening. Have you felt it?
To me, what was so exciting about The Force Awakens was that feeling of this brand new adventure, this brand new story that would be a bridge between what we know and who we know and everything that comes next.
Certainly for all young kids, they either wanted to be Luke Skywalker or they saw themselves as Han Solo. And I think that was a part of our challenge, was how are we going to bring new characters into this series that had that same kind of power.
While there was never a doubt that the visual opportunities were enormous, the worlds we would travel to, the creatures we would meet, the weapons and ships and landscapes that we would see would be stunning and exciting. None of that matters if you don't love the people in the ships. So at the core of this story had to be the thing that makes any story work, which is the characters.
It doesn't end there, though. This is just the first step on a long path for Star Wars into the future.
The Star Wars stories, as individual standalone films, gave us the opportunity to explore some new territory. Some of them will be grounded in things that are familiar. Rogue One is about an event that's referenced in the crawl of Episode 4, the theft of the Death Star plans. What I love is that we are able to diversify Star Wars storytelling, explore some different genres, and yet stay inside the sort of larger galaxy of Star Wars that we all recognize.
There's so much story that we're telling across multiple movies, across different television shows, across all kinds of different media.
We're tasked with developing those stories and making sure they're cohesive, that they connect.
One of the things we always ask ourselves in the story group is, what's the best format for a story to be told? Is it a movie? Is it something in the animated space? Or is it a book or a comic?
Working on story and helping to guide those filmmakers and looking for ways in which we can push technology, that's what keeps it exciting and new and relevant. And what better way to do that than inside the Star Wars universe?
It is like some sort of, I was going to say, it's kind of like a renaissance here, but it's not even that because we were never even doing this before. This is turning out a movie a year.
Everything from Rogue One and the other movies and shows like Rebels have the opportunity to do things that are both visually and tonally a little different to what you might consider classic Star Wars.
Everyone, hang on!
I think it's fantastic what Dave Filoni and the Rebels crew have done to create that show. I think we've created some really wonderful characters, and kind of establishing what the Rebellion was like in its early stages, I think that's been really, really exciting.
I think there are a lot of kids who grew up on the prequels and on Clone Wars who are really excited about Rebels because in a way it picks up the story that they know, but their parents are excited about it because it also starts in a place that they recognize as being relevant to Episode 4.
I think to this day, Star Wars still represents this amazing universe, a place that only exists in the movies or in your imagination, but soon we're going to be building it in a physical way, a tangible way in our theme parks.
You're going to be able to walk inside these environments. You'll be on a planet. You'll be hurtling through space. It will be very, very immersive. Nice to be involved in something where everybody cares so much. It's not just that they care about it because they're a fan, but they care about it because it had something to do with their life. I think it's great, frankly, when you get a group of people in the room and they're that energized to do great work.
We found a lot of really wonderful, talented writers and filmmakers who are excited to work on Star Wars, who grew up with Star Wars, who love it.
The very first kind of movies that I and a lot of the people in my generation were making in our heads as kids was in that world of Star Wars.
I don't think I'm lying when I say Star Wars means the world to me. I just really wish someone had told me when I was 4 that I was going to get to make a Star Wars film, because I would have spent the last 36 years planning it.
It doesn't matter what age you are or where you grew up, there's something about Star Wars that you can connect with. It's more than entertainment. It's a very, very unique cultural force, and it's just as relevant now as it ever has been.
You go out in the world and you see a little kid engaging with Star Wars, and you understand it's their parents that have brought them into this world. It's this great generational thing, and if I'm able to help give a father or mother that gift that they pass along to their children, I think, you know, that's incredible.
I don't know what it must be like to be a kid growing up with this much awesome. I don't know how it would have affected me. I probably would have been making film by the time I was 6. We're gonna need those kids in the future to keep this thing going, because there's a lot to do.
I think with Star Wars, what people are looking forward to is sharing it with their friends, with their family, with their kids. And there's so many things on the horizon that I think we're going to have an amazing array of entertainment to thrill audiences for decades to come.
The Force will be with you. Always.
Mesdames et messieurs, nous espérons que vous avez passé un agréable moment en notre compagnie et vous souhaitons une excellente soirée Star Wars.
Ladies and gentlemen, we hope you had a great time here at the Discoveryland Theater. We wish you a wonderful Star Wars.